This is Liz Colburn, host of The Morning Uplift. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media.
This is Rachel Mullins, host of Hashtag No Filter Friday, here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media. Once you're done with this episode, I hope you'll come check out my new show, Hashtag No Filter Friday, where we talk about all of the sexual misconduct allegations swirling around Hollywood. A new show drops every Friday at 8:30 Pacific Standard Time. Don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you'll never miss an episode of Hashtag No Filter Friday. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Hey guys, Hollywood Happy Place is powered by Zoom, the leader in modern enterprise video communications. They have got an easy, reliable cloud platform for video and audio communications, so I can schedule an interview that will automatically be recorded. Then, all my guests and I need to do is click the link and we are in. Best of all, I get a clear, downloadable recording of every conversation emailed right to me in seconds. It's that easy. So if you've been looking for your own simple podcasting or conferencing solution, I suggest that you get your free account today. Just visit zoom.us and check it out for yourself. Yo, 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 and hello, everyone. This is Jerry Strauss, and this is Hollywood Happy Place. Thank you so much for tuning in. We've got a really cool chat for you this time out with one of those faces that you may not have known the name, but you are definitely going to know who this young lady is. Lisa Jakub, she's been a prominent part of some of the biggest, most successful and popular movies that you may remember. You know, everything from Independence Day to Mrs. Doubtfire. And she is here to talk to us all about not only that, but her transition in life from being a big star on the big screen to leaving Hollywood pretty much cold turkey and following her heart, her dreams, her passions to become a writer, to become someone who has released several books and has also become very involved in yoga and meditation and leading these events that help us kind of address our own anxieties and stress and things that she herself has experienced. Very cool from someone who has been there, seen it all, done it all, and lived to not only tell the tale, but forge an entirely new path for herself. Again, before we get into it, as always, want to thank you for tuning in, whether it's through Apple or Google or Spreaker or iHeartRadio. Please continue to do so. Please subscribe. Make sure that our new episodes are coming at you just as soon as they are released. Leave us reviews or five-star ratings or whatever the case may be. If you're liking what we're doing, we certainly appreciate that. And again, this is Lisa Jakub. You're going to love it. It's on Hollywood Happy Place.
Love it when that comes together.
I know, it's amazing. It's I would never take the 5 minutes to just try it out on my own, but necessity is the mother of reinvention, I guess. So
excellent.
Yeah, so thank you for rescheduling and everything. I know everything on my end got screwed up this week with the
problem. Where are you? Where do you live?
I'm in Jersey.
Got it. Okay.
And you're on the East Coast too, so you're further.
Yeah, we're in Virginia.
Okay.
Yeah. So we're in Virginia.
Did you get affected by anything, or did it not start that far down?
No, we got some winds, but that was about it. Okay. Yeah. Did you guys get hammered?
Oh yeah, we had to take a couple days to kind of everyone dig ourselves out, and school was stopped in the whole thing. So
our
week was kind of destroyed. Love when that happens, but
I remember my husband and I lived in New Jersey for about 2 years. We were in Morris County, and I remember the winters being like, "Oh, this is no joke." Like, this is serious.
Well, this is one of those years where it lulled us into a false sense of security. We had like one major storm months ago and then nothing. And we're like, oh, no snow this year. And then they got us right at the end.
Well, hopefully you're done now.
Like, I hope
That'll clear out.
I hope so. Sorry, I'm just pulling
less
up.
Shoveling in the future.
I know, yeah. I'm done.
Yeah.
If there's more snow, it's just staying.
That's what happens in March, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, I mean, thank you also for shooting the link to your book, et cetera, et cetera. So if there's anything else you want to talk about specifically, just go for it. Like, I've been trying not to be super planned out or formatted or anything. So,
yeah. No, that always ends up being the way to get a more fun conversation, I think. So that's great.
Yeah. And we've talked before, and I don't quite remember when, but I know it's been a while, but we did it for something else.
Yeah, maybe around the first book.
Maybe. There was a point, you know what I think it was? I think it was for a website called ravishly.com that I used to do a lot of stuff for. And yeah, I think if I were to go back, that's where I would find where that would live.
Yeah.
It was a while ago. So good to catch up. And
absolutely.
I tried to do a little bit of prep for this, a little bit of research. And I mean, I got to tell you this right off the bat, based on your direction and this book and everything that you're doing, I feel like this conversation has become a little bit intimidating.
And oh, no.
Yes. Because before, and, you know, everybody knows you, of course, you know, everyone knows Lisa and knows your face and knows your voice from some of the movies that not only that we loved back in the 90s, Mrs. Doubtfire and Independence Day, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, these are movies that on any given day, I mean, you'd be hard-pressed to find a day where at least one of these movies is not playing on a major cable network, like during the week, weekend, whatever. Like, they're just omnipresent parts of our pop culture at this point, past, present, and future. So you're everywhere, and I'm sure you're probably tired of it to an extent. But beyond that, now you're in this whole new direction where not only is it, do you have that star power of being in our living rooms all our lives, but now that you've got this mastery of, you know, psychological and mental things that you're helping people with and you're talking about, I feel like you're analyzing me already.
Oh my gosh. No.
And we're not.
Okay. Let's take the word mastery just completely out of the vocabulary here, because I am like struggling like everybody else, which is why I wrote that book. So let's take this way down.
Okay. So I mean, let's paint the picture here, because you're someone who is so cool and inspirational and inspiring, I think, in a lot of ways, because you achieved such a degree of success early in your career in front of the camera, and then you made the bold decision to start over and go in an entirely different direction. And it's something that I feel like we can say you've done more than once in your life, because you decided, hey, I'm going to be a writer. And then you're writing all these different kinds of things. And hey, I'm going to be a published author. And now, instead of pigeonholing yourself as far as what you're doing or what you're writing, you've decided to write something in another new direction, which is your new book, which is Not Just Me. So, I mean, is this, first of all, something you get more and more comfortable with over time, just deciding this is what I'm passionate about and this is what my focus is going to be now?
Wow. Well, first of all, thank you for those very kind words. Yeah, I think reinventing yourself is always scary, and doing something new that, you know, you're not necessarily good at, right? Nobody's good at things when they first start. And so that idea of hey, I want to go in a new direction and explore this and try this. It's always scary. But I think I realized, like, I left Los Angeles. I walked away from my acting career, from my friends, from my entire life to find something that I was passionate about. And if I got out here into the world outside of Hollywood and then felt too scared to actually pursue the things that I am passionate about, then why the hell did I bother leaving LA? You know? So I really felt like once I made that major leap, it's like, oh, well, now I just really have to do it because I have that opportunity, and that's precious. That's an amazing thing. And everybody has that, right? Everybody has their one life and they get to make decisions, and there are consequences to those decisions, and those decisions are complicated, and people might be mad about those decisions. So it's very layered and very difficult, but at the end of the day, it's like, if you see something that you get excited about, something that sparks that thing in your soul, go do it. Because otherwise you're kind of stuck in that monotony that maybe is not making you happy. So it's always scary and it's always worth it.
Do you feel like, I mean, because it's scary, I guess, just the idea of facing a real thing that you could potentially succeed or fail at, I guess. And sometimes it can look that black and white, although it's probably not. But beyond all that, I mean, in your life, what's your experience been like as far as other people, feedback, people around you, or just potentially critics, people who may give you some pushback when you go from one world to another, just because maybe of assumptions that they might make about whether you will be able to succeed in an entirely new world? Is it something that you've kind of encountered at all, positively or negatively?
Yeah, all the time. All the time. From people who had very strong opinions about me leaving an acting career and moving to Virginia, which, you know, if you're in LA and in the acting world, Virginia might as well be, you know, Neptune. It's just really, really far away. To anonymous comments on pieces that I write online where, you know, it's always the really brilliant comment of just sort of like, you suck, you know, or whatever that feedback is. People have a lot of opinions and people love their opinions and they are entitled to them, but I am not entitled to care about their opinions.
Right.
And that was a pretty big aha moment for me. There is a great Gandhi quote that says something to the effect of, I will not let you walk through my mind with your dirty feet. Hmm. And I love that because I have anxiety. I struggle with depression. I have mood issues. And so I tend to hang on to any sort of negative feedback that I get. You can tell me 20 things about how amazing I am, and then that one thing of like, I didn't really like it. That's the thing that will keep me up at 3 o'clock in the morning and I will obsess about. Mm. And I think a lot of people are like that. And realizing that everyone's allowed to their opinion, but I have the power to decide that they don't get to tromp through my mind with their dirty feet and their dirty opinions at 3 o'clock in the morning. That's something that I can do. And I can choose to not read the comment.
That's an amazing frame of mind. And I think whether you are clinically, you know, dealing with issues with depression or anxiety or not, I think most of us tend to look at the negative more easily. I remember a story I heard once, sort of questioning the idea of when a child comes home with 4 A's and an F, 9 times out of 10, the parent goes to the F first and focuses on that. Why aren't they focusing on the fact that they got 4 A's and then saying, okay, what did they do right in those four classes that can bring the F up and make the focus the positive? But we just kind of tend to do that. But I mean, for you to have that mindset of not letting that extra negativity get in, is that something that you kind of had to develop over time, or is that something that you've been armed with since early on?
That is a daily practice. That is something that is incredibly difficult for me to do, but I think it's also incredibly important, because as an artist, as a writer, if you get bogged down in the criticism, you're never going to create anything. And that desire to be liked, to have, you know, more Twitter followers, or to create something that's perfect, the whole perfectionism thing, that just kills the creativity before it can happen. So I realize how vital it is to be able to, you can't change the thoughts, you can't really control this monkey mind that all of us humans have been given. But what we can do is reorient and have a different relationship with those thoughts. And for me, it has been all about meditation. And meditation has really, really helped me to realize that thoughts are just thoughts. They're not actually who I am, and they don't run my life. They don't run the show. Yeah. They just kind of come flitting through and wreak havoc. But I can decide, oh, yeah, okay, that monkey mind of mine, it's doing that thing again. I don't need to be totally involved and invested with that. I can shift my focus to something else. And that has been what has been the most impactful, helpful thing for dealing with criticism. And the criticism could come from other people, or it could, you know, come from inside the house, right? It could be from me. And being able to recognize that, oh yeah, that's my brain doing that thing where it criticizes to try and keep me small because I'm scared. And being able to see that really shifts the relationship with it.
Did you find that it was specifically a challenge to deal with that in your acting career? I mean, I just find it's so interesting that, I mean, you've gone from being from acting to writing. I mean, these are probably at the top of the list of careers that actually invite the most criticism and potentially stress and et cetera, et cetera. I mean, you're very brave. You're very brave. But I mean, you talked about.
Thank you. There are definitely days. There's a yogurt shop that's like down the street from my house. And there are days when I'm like, I really want to go work at that yogurt shop, because there's something so simple and sweet about that, where I was like, that would just be great. I bet that would be awesome.
No, but you see, still, wait.
Writing is my passion, and now I'm stuck with it.
Yeah, and you know, if you were going to do the yogurt shop thing, you should have done it before social media, because I'm telling you, you go work at that yogurt shop, someone's going to be tweeting in about an hour after your first shift that you got their order wrong. It's not going to save you.
And I would get their order wrong. So yeah, probably best that I just stick with the whole writing thing and deal with the criticism.
Well, do you find, clearly you're someone who has decided to prioritize your passion over your anxiety, over your fears, over any negativity towards that. You haven't let any of that hold you back, which is, I mean, that in and of itself, to me, makes you an authority on how to deal with such feelings in life. You know, because you're showing and proving you've done it, you're continuing to do it. But I mean, now you've gone on to an even deeper end of the pool, in that not only are you writing about anxiety and depression, et cetera, but you're actually like leading these events where you're inviting people and positioning yourself as the leader, in which you have to kind of talk in front of people and, you know, kind of lead them through weekends of exercises and practices in order to explore their own feelings of this nature. I mean, that sounds terrifying to me. Like, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think, like, substitute teaching sounds scary, but it sounds a lot scarier to be in charge of adults. And now you're putting yourself in that role.
So first of all, it is terrifying. And I am terrified every time that I do it. However, I think the way I see it is not so much that I am a leader and I am going there and I am standing up and I am telling people, like, I know everything about this. Let me tell you how to fix your lives. I see it as I'm creating a community of people who are experiencing similar things, and I'm giving people a space where we can come together and we can share strategies and we can laugh about the ridiculous stuff that happens when you are going through life as an overly sensitive, introverted, shy person with anxiety. And what happens on these retreats is that everybody is helping each other. I learn as much on these things as the people who are attending as participants. And I think what a lot of us are missing in our modern busy lives is that, like, really intimate connection of, let's put the phone down, let's look in each other's faces, and let's talk about the deep stuff that actually matters, the things that are going to help us to get through the day, to have better relationships with the people we love, to be able to go out into the world and do the work that we think is important, but there are a million voices in our heads that are holding us back. Mm-hmm. So I think I really feel like I'm just kind of setting up this camp where we get to go and talk about important stuff. And I think that reframing really helps me to not feel like a terrified substitute teacher, but just super excited that I get to help people make these connections. And hopefully they go home from the weekend and they feel like they have some new strategies. Because I think a lot of us who are struggling feel like we don't know what else to try. We feel stuck. We feel alone. We feel like nobody else can get it. And being able to sit with 20 people who all are experiencing the same things, it gives you this feeling of, like, okay, I'm renewed, and now I have some things that I can try to go out in the world with.
Is it, I mean, I would imagine it also gives you and everyone who attends a bit of just empowerment, a sense of empowerment, just because of the fact that you're facing the fear of going to this social thing and dealing with people. And that in and of itself is, you know, it's almost kind of like facing down a bit of what might be a phobic part of, you know, what you might be feeling. Is it something empowering for you just to get to the dance, so to speak, before the weekend even starts?
Yeah, absolutely. And I feel like we all sort of get through this thing. So many of us feel like we're not allowed to be nervous about something. We're not allowed to be scared. We're not allowed to find something absolutely terrifying. Mm-hmm. And the thing is that you can. And you can also be brave. You know, you can be scared of something and do it anyway and be, like, totally kick-ass at it. Just because it's scary doesn't mean that you have to shut it down. And just because you're anxious doesn't mean you're not incredibly courageous. And so I think being able to hold those two things is really powerful.
What's something that, I mean, as an example for those who are listening who either feel like they don't have these fears and anxieties, which I don't buy, by the way, because I think everyone has some level of anxiety about something to some extent. But, like, for an example, for someone like you who is just so kind of self evolved, I guess, that you you actually are very much in touch with the things that may upset you or set you off. What are some things that may happen just during the course of a normal day, or things that may come up that might give you anxiety?
Oh God, the list is endless. Yeah, I think there are so many things that all of us encounter in daily life that can be stressful, whether it's other people's expectations of what we should be doing. I mean, I don't know a single person that hasn't at some point been awake in their bed in the middle of the night going, have I accomplished enough with my life? Have I really done, I should, and then we start shoulding all over the place. I should be married. I should have kids. I should have a better job. I should have more money. I should have a bigger house. I should have a nicer car. I should have more friends. I should have a bigger Facebook following. There are so many expectations that are just put on us by society that we then internalize and put on ourselves. And I think that process just amplifies, right? Because we take it in and then it ends up affecting so many other things in our lives, so that we end up, having a panic attack and snapping when somebody, cuts us off in traffic because we're so amped up about these other things. So I think it can be, such a benefit for everybody to just have that moment of stepping back and going, okay, let me look around at my life and let me see if it truly does reflect who I want to be in the world. And if it does, fantastic. That's awesome. But if it doesn't, then it's okay to really step back and think like, okay, what changes do I need to make? And that might be, something external, or it might be, an inner shift that I was talking about before, that like, hey, I want to do things differently. And changing habits, especially mental habits, it's really, really hard, but it's completely possible. And that part, I loved doing all the research for my book about neuroplasticity and the way that the brain works. Mm-hmm. And that is just such a fascinating subject, because we used to think that old dogs can't learn new tricks, right? If you've been doing something a certain way for a long time, it's just the way it's going to happen, and give up any hope of changing. But we're learning about how the brain works and how the neurons fire, and you can make those actual physical changes within the brain that changes the structure and changes the way that you react to things. And I just think that is fascinating stuff and incredibly empowering, especially when you're feeling stuck in the habit of anxiety, depression, stress, that anger response that can come out, all of those sorts of things. Like, you have the power to change that. It's super duper hard work, but you can actually do it if you're motivated to.
Well, you mentioned physical changes to the brain, and I'm sure there's people out there, or maybe it's just me, who is now envisioning taking out a tool belt and going to the skull and being like, all right, I'm going to recarve this thing and try and, fix it. Because metaphorically, that's kind of what we always want to do, right? We want to just, if there's an issue, if there's a problem, we just want to fix it. And make everything okay. When you say physically make changes to the brain, what are some exercises, or what are things that you kind of need to do or adopt in order to make those changes on a long-term basis?
Yeah. So there's a great quote, that is, the neurons that fire together wire together. So if you have a certain response to something that happens, so something happens and then you have the response, and something happens and you have that same response. So those neurons in the brain are going to actually wire together. It's Pavlov's dog, right? It's hear the bell, salivate. And so what happens is that you can actually undo that and have different neurons wiring together by changing the reaction. So I know I've talked about meditation. This is another brilliant use of meditation, because what meditation teaches you how to do is that when the issue happens, instead of immediately going to that response that you've been wired to go to, you take a moment and you take a breath. And in that moment, you pick a different response. So you can say, God, every time my mother says that thing about my weight, I fly off the handle and, you know, say whatever. And then we end up in a huge fight and it ends up being the thing.
Right.
And so it's this idea of, okay, mom's going to say the thing about the weight. And then instead of going into attack mode, you take a breath. Mm-hmm. And then you decide what is going to be the most mindful response rather than the reaction. And so it might be saying, God, you know what? That's really hurtful. It might be walking away. It might be any number of things, but you can change that habit. And it might actually be better. Oftentimes, it's better than our knee-jerk reactions.
Yeah.
But when we meditate, it becomes easier to do that in the real world when somebody's just made the comment that makes you want to fly off the handle.
Well, it's interesting because if you think about it, it's almost like it's teaching yourself new mental habits, retraining your brain. And I almost wonder if it's a similar process to some of the negative things that we pick up, like, oh, I'm stressed at a certain level, or I'm stressed about this. I'm going to go like eat a bag of potato chips or something like that. And eventually that becomes your natural thing, or I'm going to go grab a beer or a six pack or whatever the case may be. It almost sounds like it's kind of like that, but you're instead taking control of it and forcing, or, you know, making yourself do positive things in response to those negative things, which is obviously a lot more healthy. Is that kind of a similar situation?
Absolutely. You're just sort of you're rerouting. Because what a lot of us tend to do when faced with stressful, difficult situations, our go-to is actually really detrimental for us. You know, it might be grabbing the six pack or, you know, whatever that might be for you. And then, you know, the next day you're like, oh God, that was a really bad choice, but it felt so automatic because it was just the habit. And so that's where we can try to step in and be like, hold on, maybe I can do something in this response that's going to be a little bit more beneficial for me.
Very cool. So, I mean, we've talked about the book. Let's go back to it just for a second and let people know the whens, the wheres, and the hows they can check out the book. Do you recommend that if they're planning to go to one of your events, they read the book first, or are they two totally separate things?
I would be happy for them to read the book first, but it is not, it's not required reading. We do talk about some of the stuff from the book at the various events. So not required reading, but, I mean, it's definitely a good introduction to the stuff that I like to talk about. And so, yeah, I like to say this because certainly anxiety and depression have these really heavy, difficult connotations. And I have to tell you that at these events, we spend most of our time laughing. And it's so much fun and we have such a good time. And I think it just feels so freeing to know that, like, there are no taboo topics. We are completely ditching the shame around mental health issues, and we're just talking and bonding. And I'm always amazed at, like, how much fun we have at these things. Yeah.
Very cool. So I mean, again, the book is out there. The book is not just me. And is that, I mean, is there anywhere specific you want to point people to get it? Or, I mean, it's clearly on Amazon, yeah, et cetera, et cetera. Is that the best place?
Yeah. So you can get more information about the book at notjustmebook.com. You can also go to my website, which is Lisa Jakub. Jakub is JAKUB.net. And I have links and a blog and all of that kind of stuff there. So you can get more information there. But yes, it's on Amazon. It's an ebook. It's a paperback. It's an audiobook. And so lots of different versions. And if anybody is interested, on my website, and they can do it through notjustmebook.com, I do have signed and personalized copies that folks can order if they want.
Oh, very cool. And you know, obviously, if you've got your schedule on your website as well, so people can see where and when your events are taking place, they can plan. When is your next one?
So at the end of this month, so it's Easter weekend, it's March 30th, and I'm going to be up at Kripalu Center for Yoga and Health, which is one of my favorite places on the planet. And so that is up in Lenox, Massachusetts, in the Berkshire Mountains. It's absolutely gorgeous. And so I'm going to be doing yoga and writing for anxiety. And so you don't have to have any experience with yoga or any experience with writing. Everyone is welcome to just come and play and have a great weekend.
Cool. Very cool. So is there any other way that you encourage people to follow you, to keep abreast of everything you've got going on? Do you encourage people to your social media?
Yeah, absolutely. I am on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, and I am on Instagram. So all of those places are excellent ways to follow me, to find me, and to see way too many pictures of my very adorable dog. So go there for the dog pictures, if nothing else.
Go for the dog pictures, stay for the great information and good advice and updates on everything, Lisa. Lisa, so cool to catch up with you today. It was great for you to share all this stuff about all this new stuff you're doing. I don't feel scared anymore, although I feel like you probably took a lot of notes. I probably should have been laying on a couch, and you're probably going to write up something really scary about me afterwards, but I
absolutely think not true. We're all in this together, man. We're all in this together.
Cool. It's good to know. Thank you for leaving me with a feel-good moment.
Thank you so much for the conversation. It was great.
You too. Thanks. Bye.
Okay, bye. Just fucking come already. What makes you take so fucking long? Are you sick? Is your dick broken? What's going on, Gus? Why did you build it up for so fucking long? It's not the next fucking Star Wars movie, you nerd. Oh, and by the way, we all heard you jacking off the porn last night. Oh, Bernie, I can't.
What?
It sounded gross.
Okay, so what? I was watching porn, but it's not like I'm jacking off.
You were jacking off.
spacecraft?
I don't think it ever becomes a spacecraft.
No, it does actually. It can't go above like 400 or 500 feet before it's designated a spacecraft. Or maybe 5 miles. Starts really high up. Like, we can see all the trees. We see all the mountains, the trees and everything, and then it slowly comes back down to Earth. And you see the two of us, and we're softly kissing each other. And then it's going to come up really close to our faces. And I was working on the special effect where it could actually go inside of our bodies. And it would like go down within us and to our stomachs. And our guts and our innards. And then you see my heart. It was beating faster because I was kissing you.
I don't want to do that now. It's still.
Thank you.
Oh.